Good morning, Southwestern College. You had coffee. You can do better than that. Good morning. Okay, we have a great program for you today. I'm Zanita Encarnacion, the Chief of Staff here. You will see on our slides that we have a QR code. You're going to hear from some amazing speakers, and you're going to have questions that pop into your mind. I encourage you to use the QR code, scan it, submit your questions, and we will get through as many questions as we possibly can today. Before we get started, as people settle in, we're going to share a video of some student stories, because that is all of our whys. So let's hear from our students, and then we'll get the program started. Thank you.
I want to get my bachelor's in English and literature. I'm also thinking of being ambitious and getting my minor in creative writing. And after that, I want to be a librarian, so I'm going to be working to get my master's in library and information science. I'm a system impacted student, and there's this kind of quiet stigma that you're not worthy enough to attain higher education or go to college and things like that. And I became a part of the Rising Scholars program here on campus, and they welcomed me with open arms. Like, the first day I walked in there, they gave me a hug. And from that moment, I've been kind of shedding off that feeling of not being worthy or deserving. So I am forever grateful for Southwestern for allowing me to, you know, deal with these obstacles and actually helping me overcome them. When I became a Rising Scholar, one of the first things I did after enrolling in classes was signing up for the Basic Needs program. And after my interview, they already knew that I was dealing with housing insecurity, and I also let them know once I actually became homeless. And just simply by asking and actually being vulnerable, you know, it's kind of embarrassing, but if you don't ask for the help, you can't really receive it, you know? The community needs to invest in Southwestern because it's going to allow the students to be the best versions of themselves. And, you know, that art of giving, when you give, the students in turn give, because that's what I do. I mean, I don't give monetarily because I'm still a poor college student, but I give with my time. I volunteer in the community. I advocate for my fellow Rising Scholars. So that generosity that's shown, students repay that back in so many ways.
I'm going to be attending UNIT Berkeley in the fall, and I'm going to be studying political science, and I hope to pursue a career in politics with it. Everyone here is actually really welcoming. I didn't expect to receive the support that I did, not just from staff on campus, but also from students. They're all very encouraging and supportive, and they have been throughout my entire journey, especially the newspaper staff. By giving me technical skills, so my writing has really developed, but also giving me life skills, I feel like I've become so much more. I mean, it sounds cliche, but organized, and I've really found really, you're forced and encouraged to find your own way of learning that's best for you, organization. It's helped prepare me for my future education in the real world, where I have to pursue and learn things on my own. Because the youth that they are investing in, the students that they are investing in, they're the future of our community and potentially of our nation and the world. They're the ones that are going to be leading, so we want them to have a very well-rounded education like the one that Southwestern College provides. So we're not just investing in the college, we're investing in our youth and our people by helping it.
I plan to continue to invest time and effort into my business. I'm on my second business right now. I'm here local to Chula Vista, California, and I have taken two certificate programs here at Southwestern, e-business and e-commerce. QUC has prepared me a lot in terms of I have the technical skills now. I graduated in 2022 here at SWC with a certificate in film, television, and media arts, which helped me just learn how to do the projects I do now for my clients. That was one certificate, and now with the e-commerce and e-business certificate, I am getting a better understanding of how to operate a business, how to have a profit and loss statements, just understanding the infrastructure of a business. Because as a freelancer, the last couple years, I've enjoyed the freedom of figuring it out. However, I never took the time to truly educate myself in business, and this is what I'm doing now here at Southwestern. Right now, I'm currently the president for the Native American Students and Allies Club here on campus. That community has helped me just plug myself in more to the club, the ASO clubs here. Not just that, but there's a learning hub community where you can go and hang out with other students and just do homework, get some snacks. Those are things that I didn't know while I was here in the first 2 years that, oh, look, there's all these opportunities for students just to gain community support, build relationships, and hopefully those relationships turn into professional connections in the future. Not only do we cater to the local surrounding South Bay communities, but also to across the border in Tijuana. I've seen Southwestern invest their funds into ensuring that we get students from across the border to our campus. I've seen them work on student academic support programs to help these students with ESL, and not just the international students. There's also lifelong learners, people who are coming in from older adults, or like myself, who already has a bachelor's and coming in. Like, the college has done a really good effort in making sure to let us know that, hey, we have resources and we're here. And for that is an asset for here in the South Bay, and I want to see it continue to grow. So we need to invest in Southwestern Community College.
Can we just give a hand to our students? I mean, if that isn't a why, I don't know what is. And with that, I do want to recognize some important people here, probably the most important in our ASO leadership. I see Chris and Leo back there. We also have students under Professor Duren's leadership who are live streaming our event, so thank them for that. And then we also want to thank our governing board members. There we go. Our governing board members, I do see Trustee Dumas, President Dumas, and Vice President Brown. We also have the mayors of Chula Vista and National City. Please raise your hand so we can recognize you. We have National City Chula Vista Council members Titas Yamani and Alonzo Gonzalez as well. Sweetwater Union High School and San Isidro School District board members Nick Segura and Rudy Lopez. Representatives from the office of Congressmember Juan Vargas and Senator Steve Padilla. We have representatives from the Consul General of Mexico, our strong binational partners, and all of our universities, including those from Baja California today. So thank you all for joining us. To start our program, I'm gonna call President Dumas up, and we are going to start it with a land acknowledgement.
Thank you, Z, and welcome everyone to Southwestern College. We are very thrilled to have everyone here. Thank you for joining us as we release our Education Vision Plan 2030 and hear important updates from our special guests. So we're gonna begin our program, as Zanita mentioned, with a land acknowledgement. We acknowledge the land upon which we sit and occupy today as the current, traditional, and ancestral home of the Kumeyaay Nation. Before they were colonized and genocide occurred, Kumeyaay territory was vast and included Baja California to the south, Palomar Mountain to the north, and the Salton Sea to the east, and in fact included Southwestern College locations of Chula Vista, San Ysidro, National City, and Otay Mesa. Without them, we would not have access to this gathering or any of the services and benefits our district provides. We take this opportunity to recognize the more than 500 years of demonstrated resilience and resistance in the face of violent actions taken by colonizers in efforts to separate them from their land, culture, and one another. We acknowledge that despite this history, the Kumeyaay Nation continue to be an active, thriving people who contribute to the health and benefit of our region. Let us not only remember, but acknowledge as a conscientious political act that the land we are on is occupied Kumeyaay territory. It is now my pleasure to introduce Southwestern College graduate and Superintendent President, Dr. Mark Sanchez.
I think there's a clicker here for me. Good morning, everyone. How's everyone doing? Thank you, Board President Dumas, for that welcome. Very much appreciated, and appreciate your and Vice President Brown's leadership. Thank you for giving us the support that we need to lead the district into the future. It's great to be here with you all. I saw one of our students from the student video, Lucia. I see you. Lucia, Chloe, and Nicolette are truly examples of the brilliance that we have in our student body here at Southwestern College. So thank you for being here this morning. Your story is powerful. Let's go ahead and get started. Let's have some fun. How's everyone doing this morning? Yeah. Oop, went the wrong way. I always like to start my presentations by highlighting the community that we serve. We serve a rich and diverse South County of San Diego. We also serve a Tijuana, Baja California region that we take very seriously in our partnerships, as well as our tribal nations in our region. So this is the community that we serve, and this is the community that we create a pathway for in career preparation and educational programming. Let's start with some celebrations. This is the work that the college has done, and this is data that's year to date. That's our theater director, Brandon, who always tries to surprise me with some good news. So. Nicely done, Brandon. So we've increased student access. Our full-time equivalent student enrollment has increased by 3.5% over the pandemic. So if you're wondering what full-time equivalent students is it's a blend of our headcount, each individual student, combined with the number of units that they're enrolled in. This is actually how we're funded by the state, and why it's important is because it's research-based. So what it's essentially saying is that our students are enrolling in more units. There's a lot of data out there that suggests that when students take 15 units, they're more likely to complete their educational goal in a California community college. So this is why at many colleges throughout the state, you'll see campaigns, marketing campaigns, 15 to finish. So it's really based around the unit load that students take in order to complete the educational goal that they've set for themselves. Student support, our financial aid, our PAL, our free financial aid to students, and I see our financial aid team here. I see our Dean of Enrollment Services. (Clears throat) As of yesterday, when I completed this slide, we've distributed $31.7 million in Pell financial aid to our students. We know based on the research that providing financial support to students is critical in their success, but the reason why that data point is so prominent is because it's the largest amount of Pell financial aid we've distributed at Southwestern College to our students over the last 7 years. This even exceeds pre-pandemic distribution numbers. It's a huge data point. In addition, student success, our degrees and certificates for this semester, this academic year, is at 3,690, which makes this one of the largest graduating classes in Southwestern College history. If you're familiar with how community colleges are funded, this is also the three data metrics that demonstrate how colleges are funded based on the student-centered funding formula. So very proud of the work that this college is doing, and it truly is our faculty, our classified professionals, and our administrative leadership teams that are doing the work every day. I always like to use the analogy, our team is one that rolls up their sleeves, they bring their lunch pails to work, and they do the work to serve our community and our students. And I see our executive leadership team here as well, so I want to acknowledge the tremendous partners I have in our executive leadership. Thank you. Why we're here today to talk about our blueprint for success. This is really a six-year plan that lays out the roadmap for Southwestern College on how we serve our community moving forward. It's a very nice blend of business and industry input aligned with the academic programs and the career development programs we have at Southwestern College to create a pathway to our community and our students to those opportunities. There are five overarching goals in the vision plan, and we've been working on this for the last 10 months. Again, a testament of the work of our administrative leadership, our classified professionals, and our faculty engaged in laying out a future for our students that is bright. So goals one and two, the first goal is to increase enrollment, learning, skill attainment in a non-transfer pathway. This really is a highlight of our career preparation programs, and we have some amazing ones. And I happen to see our fire science director here. Good to see you, Lorraine. She leads an amazing program in our fire sciences. We are, Southwestern College is also a member of the Southwest Regional Apprenticeship Program, which is focused on training our electricians, our machinists, our pipe fitters, and other career programs to those opportunities that exist in the community. We also have an amazing culinary arts program, and we've already been approached by the leadership at the Gaylord Convention Center, which is one of the largest, newest convention centers coming to Chula Vista. The vision is to create a pathway for our culinary arts students to fulfill those job opportunities at the Gaylord Convention Center. And so we're really looking forward to that partnership. I gotta tell you right now, I just got chills, and I'm being completely honest. What's happening in Chula Vista and the South County is simply amazing. I'm really looking forward to the future of what's happening here. I also want to highlight another program that our faculty and our students are working on, and it's a hydrogen technology in our automotive program. So our students are already working on hydrogen cars, and this is really going to contribute to the carbon footprint in our region by reducing emissions moving forward. This is the newest technology that's going to be combined with electric vehicle technology, especially around the requirements for commercial long-haul trucks and the zero emissions requirements by 2030, 2040. Our faculty and our students are leading the way moving into that. And I see you, Danny. Our Danny Villanueva, our Vice President of Administrative Services, very involved in that project as well. We also want to increase student transfer in a bachelor degree pathway. So I think you're all aware that we have a University Now initiative that you'll hear more about with our subsequent speaker, Taylor Dunn, from the San Diego Regional Economic Development Corporation. But we already have Arizona State University who will begin teaching their bachelor degree programs on our Chula Vista campus beginning this August. That's combined with our existing partnerships with National University, San Diego State University, Point Loma Nazarene University, and I'm also in discussions with Pradeep Khosla to bring a bachelor degree program in nursing and physician assistant to the Chula Vista campus beginning this fall. This would be the first time that UCSD has ever had a presence in the South County. So very, very proud of these evolving partnerships. And when I talked about the hydrogen program, I see our automotive faculty, Brian Palmatier here. Just want to acknowledge Brian, thank you for your work. Amazing things happening at Southwestern College. And we also want to expand equitable student achievement. So I see our partners here from Sweetwater Union High School District. We had a board meeting this past Monday, and we had additional dual enrollment contracts on our board meeting that the board approved to expand high school students being able to take college courses embedded within their high school curriculum. What I should note is that one of the students that was highlighted in the video, Nicolette, she's actually a Bonita Vista High School student who is completing her Associate of Arts degree at the age of 17 and has already been accepted to UC Berkeley starting this fall semester. Through our partnership with Sweetwater, we want to be able to expand the number of students who have access to that pathway. And we're also working to establish an early college high school at our San Ysidro Higher Education Center that will allow students from the four high schools in that immediate service area to take a blended curriculum of high school and college coursework that will meet their A through G requirements, as well as help students secure college units at the same time. Very proud of our partnership with Sweetwater. Thank you for your work. We also have a Men of Color program here. Very proud of our Men of Color team. Thank you. I see Ronnie and Keith here. And sorry there's bright lights in my eyes, but thank you for your work. Our Men of Color program is really, really intentional because as we've looked at the data, as we've emerged from our pandemic, we see that there's three primary groups that have stepped away from community college enrollment, not only in the South County and in San Diego, but in the state and nation. Three primary groups, it's Filipino men, Black and African American men, and Latino men have disenrolled from the college at disproportionate rates. So having a Men of Color program that's gonna build relationships with the community to bring our students back and get them on the pathway to success, I'm very, very proud of the work you all are doing. We wanna be responsive to the changes in our student population and demographics. We know based on data that one of our largest growing populations in the South County will be our Asian American Pacific Islander community. And so our team is working with the United States Department of Education on an APESE designation, which would allow us to secure financial resources to begin to intentionally serve our Asian American Pacific Islander communities. And we want to be very intentional about how we do that. So I'm very proud of the team. And some of that is being led also by our Chief of Staff, Zanita Encarnacion. So thank you all for your work on bringing that to fruition. We also want to work to bolster the district's infrastructure. When I look at this picture, I see an amazing juxtaposition. It's our Performing Arts Center, which is what we're in now, supported by the community. So thank you to the community for your support in bringing this amazing facility to fruition. This facility has allowed us to bring arts and entertainment that has never been in the South County to the South County, specifically through partnerships with the San Diego Symphony, the San Diego Opera, and the San Diego Ballet. Those performances are now available to people who live in our community. And I always talk about that because one of the indicators of a community's health is that their access to arts and entertainment, world-class arts and entertainment. We want our community. If they want to go to the Rady Shell, that's fine. But if you want to be able to access some of those world-class performances, we want you to be able to access those in your own community. One of the things, I love Martha Gilmer with the San Diego Symphony. She has been very intentional about wanting to bring those partnerships to Chula Vista. As a matter of fact, Rafael Payer, the lead conductor for the Rady Shell, was here meeting with our students, talking about his career trajectory, and really sharing how students can be very intentional on pursuing their music career. And so that's the type of access we want to be able to build to our community. On the flip side, we also have portions of our district that are very, very old. As you can see on the right-hand side, you see the trellises from our originally built buildings in the 1960s have rotted and have fallen down. And so all of this is to say that every building in this district should be able to provide a world-class educational learning experiences for all of our students that step foot onto our campus. In order to do that, we have to be able to have the facilities that create optimal learning environments for our students, for our community. And so we'll be looking to the community for your support and how we move courageously into the future to provide that learning environment for our students. Our goal is simple. We want to improve the opportunity trajectory for our students in the South County by connecting them with the career skills and the educational skills they need to be productive members and competitive members in our workforce and in our region. Thank you for allowing me the time. I think I'm running right at time. But thank you again all for being here and supporting the work of Southwestern College. We truly, truly appreciate you. It's now my honor to introduce a colleague and someone I respect tremendously. She's working with us on the University Now Initiative Committee, Taylor Dunn from the San Diego Regional Economic Development Corporation. Thank you for being here today, Taylor.
Okay, perfect, thanks. Thank you, Dr. Sanchez. And good morning, everybody. My name is Taylor Dunn, as was mentioned, and I lead the Talent Initiatives team at San Diego Regional Economic Development Corporation. I am excited and honored to be here today to talk to you about the University Now Initiative, or UNI Committee, which I have served on for just under a year, but is a product decades in the making. We know that access to education is critical for socioeconomic mobility, as well as for economic development and business expansion. Southwestern College has been able to team up with the city of Chula Vista, leaders from state government, who you'll hear from later, and several other community partners to ensure that the development of the South County's designated higher education land is done in a way that serves, first and foremost, the residents of this community, as well as the businesses, by leveraging a demand-driven and listening-first approach. The five core activities that you see listed on the screen, the UNI committee is working through the five core activities that you see listed on the screen, the UNI committee is working to understand how this can be the best asset for this community. One thing that we know for sure is that relentless collaboration is going to be critical. The logos you see listed here represent organizations that sit on the UNI committee along with my own. From K through 12 education to higher education, both north and south of the border, to industry organizations and companies themselves, and so many more, this group brings a myriad of perspectives to the table. Transparency, open communication, and active listening among these partners will continue to be the building blocks of a successful higher education project anywhere, but especially in a place as unique and special as this one. So why, among all of those brilliant organizations, am I the one up here telling you about this today? Well, my organization, San Diego Regional EDC, gets to have a very unique seat in San Diego. Our role is to mobilize local leaders around a strategy that will bring economic prosperity to the region representing all of San Diego County. But what has become increasingly clear is that unless that strategy has inclusion as a core pillar within it, the strategy will not be successful. So we work with and through more than 200 of the largest, most influential companies in San Diego County, along with many of the partners that you've heard about today, to move the needle on increasing the number of quality jobs, talented individuals, and thriving households here in San Diego. And we do this through what we call an inclusive economic development agenda that we've encouraged several of our partners throughout the region to sign on to with us. The goals associated with this agenda were set because we don't have a choice. If the economy in San Diego County is going to continue to compete at the pace that it has for years, we must meet these goals. And all San Diegans must be benefiting from that economy. So my team is focused on the second pillar that you see here, referring to degree and credential completions. So that's obviously why the work of the UNI committee has been so important to me, but also why it's been so important to my organization as a whole. The finding for this particular body of work is that we actually need to double the number of people in our county that are completing some form of post-secondary education within 6 years of high school graduation in order to meet the future needs of our economy. So when we started this work, what we were looking at was that in every graduating high school graduating cohort, about 10,000 students were getting some sort of higher education, post-secondary education within 6 years of high school graduation. That could be a skilled trade, it could be a master's degree, anything in between. What we know is that that number needs to be 20K in order for us to meet the needs of the economy. So as I talk through this goal and how it aligns with the work of the Uni Committee and Southwestern College a little bit more, I want you to think about two things. The who and the what of those 20K skilled workers. That's really what is important and aligned about the work of my team and the work of the Uni Committee. So like any good person in economic development, I'm going to show you a little bit of economic data. Over the last 5 years, what we've seen is that job growth in San Diego County has grown about 15%, but the labor force has barely budged. This is pretty consistent with what we're seeing across the nation. That means there's more jobs available and less people to do them. So what we're seeing from a business perspective is increasing wages, increasing competition for that talent, which in some ways is a good thing, but in some ways means that we could lose businesses out of our region if we don't produce the talent that's needed to fill their jobs. Especially with some of the industries that exist in San Diego County, they have a choice to up and leave if they want to. We want to keep them here. So increasing wages, increasing job postings, increasing competition, and attraction's never going to be enough, especially in a place that's as expensive to live as San Diego County. So we have to make sure that those opportunities are available to the people who are here. What we also know is that technology will fill that gap a little bit. There's a scare around AI, but maybe it shouldn't be as scary as we're making it. There's a huge gap that has to be filled. A little bit of it could be filled by technology. But what that means is that jobs that were not previously technical jobs are going to become more technical jobs. So this goes back to that what that we're talking about. What are we skilled in, right? And this shows in the data. Over the last 5 years, job growth has concentrated in jobs that require some sort of post-secondary education, primarily a bachelor's degree. Now, the work of Southwestern College is obviously doing making great strides and helping to fill the gap and fill the people that we need to fill in these roles, especially with a 3.5% growth in enrollments. So those are the kinds of, you know, activities that we need to see continuing in the region in order for us to keep growing in the right direction. What we also know is that San Diego County, like many parts of our country, is becoming more and more diverse. So what we're looking at right here is a ethnic and demographic breakdown of various segments of the population. So over here, we're looking at just our K-12 system. That's what we would refer to as our future workforce. More than 50% of our future workforce is people of color. 49% of that future workforce is Hispanic or Latino. Within our metropolitan statistical area, so the general population, we're seeing less representation from those groups, but we know that as these young people get older and get married and have children, the diversity will increase, right? It's going to continue. And yet, some of the most high-wage, high-demand careers and industries in our region are not keeping pace with that diversity. So what we know from this is that in order for those industries to continue growing and to stay here, they inevitably are going to have to become more diverse. But if we rely solely on traditional pathways to success, the ones that we've all known for hundreds and hundreds of years, that's going to be a challenge. So what we're looking at here is a demographic breakdown of opportunity. What we know is that talent is evenly distributed and opportunity is not, and I think that's very clearly reflected on this graph. So what we begin to understand is that when we measure college ready or ready for the workforce based solely on a person's ability to go straight out of high school, straight into a four-year degree program, we're not going to be able to reach all of the people that we want to reach, at least not today, not tomorrow, hopefully soon, right? But not right now. So we have to get creative about what pathways into the workforce look like and what opportunity looks like. In a region where Black and Hispanic students make up more than 50% of our future workforce, if those folks had the opportunity to achieve at the same rate as their peers, we would not have a talent deficit, we would have a talent surplus. So we have to invest in ensuring all young people have that opportunity, but we also have to recognize that traditional pathways are not going to work for all people. This is where community college comes in hand. This is where opportunities like the ones that Southwestern College is setting up with many of their partners become so critical. When you've got a diversity of opportunity, diversity of educational options that reflects the students that are in the community, that's where we're going to start to see some success. So at the beginning, I asked you to think about the who and the what of our 20K skilled workers. And that's really where our flagship program through Advancing San Diego comes into play, and it's also where the work of the UNI committee becomes really important. You've heard me talk a lot about the who. In this context, I think it's safe to say that we're talking about Hispanic, Latino, Latina, Latinx, San Diegans, and ensuring that they have access to achievement. But in a time where the cost of education is so high, if we're going to convince communities who have been historically repressed that they should invest in their education for the good of the economy, we have got to make sure that that investment is going to show a very high return. Right? So, both of these efforts, Advancing San Diego and the UNI Committee, are inspired by a framework that was developed by the U.S. Chamber of Commerce Foundation that aims to ensure a better return on investment for students by showing businesses their own return on investment by engaging in and helping to develop the talent pipeline. So I'm going to flip back and forth between this slide and the next one a little bit. Oh. Okay, I'll talk a little bit about the UNI committee as I work through this slide as well. So through Advancing San Diego, we do a lot of this communication by running several employer working groups and surveys to understand the true needs of the businesses in our community. What are the skills that these individuals need to have when they come out of education so that they're highly prepared for high-wage jobs? We don't want to waste anyone's time. We don't want them to spend money on things that they don't need. We communicate that information back to the education partners, and those like Southwestern College are able to use that information to adapt their curriculum to make sure their students are really getting the most bang for their buck. Through the UNI committee, what this looked like was a workforce needs assessment that was conducted by the Policy and Innovation Center, as well as several community listening sessions, some of which were particularly intended for business, to sit in the room and say, what do you need in a workforce, and how can we make sure that the training programs we're developing here are going to prepare people for high-wage jobs right out of school? Through Advancing San Diego, we take this information, we bundle it together in these pretty reports, and we send it out to the universities and colleges, like I said, for them to do the curriculum updates that are needed, or for them to be recognized as what we refer to as verified programs. Southwestern College received that recognition this year through some of their computing and IT programs, indicating that they are, in fact, teaching to the needs of the students here in San Diego County so that they can get good jobs at businesses here, but also that they're reaching and serving a diverse student population that reflects San Diego. Through the UNI committee, this work looked like is looking like right now a tour of best practices from all over the country to understand where the best programs are taking place and what those programs look like, as well as a written white paper that's outlining what the best investment in this land is going to look like for years to come. Finally, the third piece of all of this is that we want to expand access. Ultimately, we want more people to have better opportunities in a way that suits them and meets them where they're at. So both for their own socioeconomic growth, as well as for the growth of the businesses here, so that they have the talent they need and the workforce to continue doing the life-changing work that they're doing in San Diego. So that's why I'm very proud to be part of the UNI committee. I see a lot of alignment with that committee and the work that we're doing at San Diego Regional EDC. It is now my pleasure to introduce Ben Cheetah, Chief Deputy Cabinet Secretary and Senior Advisor for the Cradle to Career in the office of Governor Gavin Newsom. He is an Orange Coast College grad before receiving a BA from UC Berkeley, a teaching certificate in child childhood education from Pace University, and a JD from Harvard Law School. So please join me in welcoming Ben to the Southwestern College stage.
Thanks, Taylor.
Thank you.
So raise your hand if you got into this work because you want to embed, reinforce, and entrench the status quo. It's weird because I keep asking people this question, but I can never find anybody who actually raises their hand. So riddle me this then. Why is it that it's been 64 years since we really looked at education and our strategy as Californians? Why is it that it was in 1960 that was the last time that we really looked at education strategically, big picture, as a full state? 64 years, just think about how long that has been. 64 years. 64 years means that if you were an intern working on the master plan for higher education in 1960, then today you're 84 years old. You're a 20-year-old intern, today you're 84 years old. We've lost the memory of how you do a big thing like that. Think about how long ago 64 years was. If you look at the architects of the master plan for higher education, their names like Clark Kerr, of course, but Cornelius was on the steering committee, and Wilbur was on the steering committee, and Mabel was on the steering committee. Those are literally the names. So those are the architects of the last time that we really thought about education writ large in California. And think about the student that they had in mind. In 1960, a junior in high school, a 16-year-old in high school in 1960, a person who fits that match right now, Joe Biden, President Biden. President Biden was 16 years old when the master plan was finalized. My point being that it's long overdue. It's long overdue. It's been 64 years. It's been so long that the old operative question was for Cornelius and Wilbur and Mabel to ask themselves, how do we serve a 16-year-old Joe Biden? That was their operative question. How relevant is that question to us, to this community in 2024, in 2034, in 2044? It's long overdue. But that returns to my question, my riddle. Who's stopping us? Why has it been 64 years? I'm going to pause on that question, and I'm going to unload three things that keep me up at night. I'm going to unload that burden onto you. I'm going to keep you up at night as well. So the first thing that keeps me up at night is the high school student who is down on themselves, avoiding school, maybe experiencing mental health issues. There's millions of them right now, and it's our fault. I was one of those 14-year-olds. And when I was 14, I dropped out of high school, not far from here, up in Huntington Beach. I dropped out of high school. I went to a continuation high school. I eventually enrolled at Golden West and Orange Coast and all those things. But when I had dropped out of high school for a year, I spent a whole year in my room isolated. Every day, just to be real, I thought about killing myself. The reason for why, as a 14-year-old, I wanted to kill myself was, in my mind, there was only one path to success, one path to value, one path to worth in America, in California. That is, excel in high school, get to a selective four-year university, and go to med school, law school, Wall Street, or Silicon Valley. That's how we often define success and value and worth in America writ large. That's what our young people are hearing over and over and over, and that if they're not fitting that weird paradigm of success, that they're somehow less than. That's what happened with me as well. Think about all the young people that you're interacting with, maybe your sons and daughters as well, who feel that incredible anxiety, that incredible pressure to succeed in this weird way that they don't even understand yet. And we're putting all that pressure on them. And so what we have to do is we have to rethink that experience for young people, especially from 13 to 25, where it should be all about discovery and exploration. It should not be a high-stakes bet where at 18, you have to make a bet for what you're going to do for the rest of your life. You're going to take on 7 figures in debt, and you have to figure it out from there. That's basically the system that we have right now, and it's untenable. It's intolerable. So that's the first person that keeps me up at night, is the young person who right now, ages 13 to 25, feels like they're already behind in life. But they're not. That's the period where they should be discovering, exploring, messing up, trying over again, picking themselves up. But right now, we create this incredibly inhuman pressure that has no grace for our young people, and we have to change that. So that's the first thing that keeps me up at night. We have to fix it. The second thing that keeps me up at night is the quote-unquote lifelong learner or adult learner. That should be all of us. This should just be learner. But we've taught, we all know, we're all hearing about AI, we all have anxieties, right? Here's what I want to say about that. The reason for why the 45-year-old or the 50-year-old adult learner keeps me up at night. I don't know if AI is going to create a utopia. I don't know if it's going to create a dystopia. I don't think we have to decide right now. What we do know, though, is that it's going to be a very different labor market that is very, very dynamic. And so the reason why it keeps me up at night is when that 45-year-old, 50-year-old displaced worker comes to me and says, Ben, I just lost my job. I'm living paycheck to paycheck. I have 3 kids. What door do I walk through to find another career path? First, I would say, holy cow, this is a heroic act. Thank you for getting yourself out of bed that morning, having lost that job, having had all that pressure on you, and you did a heroic thing, which is get yourself out of bed and try to get into a door. But I don't know what door to point them to. I've got 1,000 doors and no doors at all. I could tell them to Google around. I could tell them to go to an adult school or an ROP or a community college or a workforce development board program or an American Job Center or an employment training panel program. We have everything and nothing all at once. We have to build a more coherent system for adult learners to navigate the dynamism of the labor market. That we feel the dynamism now. In 10, 15 years, it's going to be crushing us. So that's the second thing that keeps me up at night. The third thing that keeps me up at night is no one's coming to save us. I got into this work, as you all did, wanting to solve problems, fix things, heal pain. But I feel every day, as I think you all do, the frustration, the fact that you're not set up for success, the fact that most of the time, your ability to serve students and families happens in spite of, not because of, the state rules and laws, processes, and programs. You spent an entire career trying to rejigger and trying to, you know, sort of problem solve and troubleshoot and braid this funding program together with this one and compete for that thing and whatever, whatever. But it's never been easy for you to serve your students and families. It's never been easy for any of us. And I was always expecting that somebody, I would eventually find the one person who, you know, raised their hand when I said, who was here to entrench the status quo? And there was like one person who's like, I'm here. I'm the one doing it. And I'm like, okay, great. I know how to, like, I'm gonna attack that person. No, there's not that person. There's no great enemy, but there's also no great hero. No one is coming to save us. We're in these rooms in Sacramento. We're in these rooms here. And over and over and over, we're the people with our hands and the levers. Our students and families are looking at us. They're depending on us. They're expecting us to fix it. And we're looking around, and it's like, holy cow, this is a big problem. I don't know how to fix this. So that's basically where we are. So I'm going to wrap with saying, what's the answer to all this? I'm not sure. But What I can tell you is that the Newsom administration has 33 months remaining. We literally count by the month. We have 33 months remaining. We've done some good things, yes, sure, but if we finished our job right now, today, I would be deeply ashamed of what we're leaving you all. Because we have not finished the job. We have seeded one-time programs. We have seeded this new thing or that new thing, this bill, that bill. But there's not yet a coherent vision. The type of vision that was articulated in 1960, and that for some reason, over the past decades, the last 64 years since, we've lost the muscle to do. We've lost the muscle over the past 64 years to really think big. But that also informs why I don't know the answer. I don't know the next step. Because, like I said, if you were an intern helping Clark Kerr in 1960, you're 84 years old right now. I actually talked to one of those interns, and I asked them, how did you all do it? And he said, I don't remember. So I don't, it's in our living memory. Nobody has done this yet. But here's what we're doing, and here's why I want to make sure I wanted to come talk to you, is in 2024, our administration is in community, talking to people. We were actually speaking to many of you a couple weeks back over at Imperial Valley College, and then I'm actually flying up to Santa Clara later on today to talk to folks in the Bay Area about this thing that we're calling the Master Plan for Career Education. What is the Master Plan for Career Education? We're trying to figure it out with you all. At this point, it stands for the proposition that we can't nickel and dime. We can't bit and bob anymore. We can't solve at the edges. We have to think holistically, especially from high school, higher ed, and beyond for adult learners. What is the coherent journey that we are building for our students and families in California? I think the greatest peril in this work, in this next 33 months for us at least, is cynicism. I don't know about you, but I use cynicism as a defense mechanism. Over and over and over, people have told me, we're gonna reimagine education, we're gonna transform the whatever, we're gonna do the blank. And it doesn't really happen. And so what happens for me at least is I get cynical, but it's like a defense mechanism. I know that if I hope that I can get hurt if it doesn't work out. So I just kind of get cynical about education reform and like change and transformation. I just kind of be like, yeah, you know, like maybe it'll happen. And what I'm saying is the biggest peril is this cynicism. And what I'm telling you from my perch, having been with the governor since literally 24 hours after he was elected in 2018, we've got a cool window right now. There's reason to be optimistic, I swear to you. When I go region by region, community by community, it's wild how much consensus there is. The time is now, that the status quo is intolerable. We might have different pictures of exactly how to fit the puzzle pieces together, but holy cow, it's like 99% agree. We just have to figure out the puzzle. Number two is convenings like this. Vision 2030, your actualization of the plan here, aligned with the chancellor's office, the state chancellor's office over in Sacramento, there's alignment. There's common direction. There's common priorities and values. There's Vision 2030, Sonia Christian, Mark. There's Mary Salas, who we appointed to the Board of Governors. We have incredible alignment at the state and community level. The last thing that gives me hope is what I'll wrap with, which is alignment among state policy leaders as well. There is an incredible amount of acknowledgement that we have to come together and have the hard conversations that have been avoided for decades and decades. And so that's why I'm especially proud to introduce Assemblymember Alvarez, who's one of the most important voices in Sacramento, and will be one of the most important voices in Sacramento in all of this work. And what I'm telling you is, What is the answer? Who is the white knight? How are we going to solve this thing? I don't know yet. But we have 33 months to try. And at the end of the day, everything that has stopped us from serving a student or family, or to do what we really wanted to do and to fix problems and to heal pain, everything that has ever stopped us has been a rule, a process, a structure built and maintained by humans. Humans just like us. If enough of us come together and hope together, we can rebuild those human-constructed and human-maintained systems. And what I'm telling you is we have partnership across humans. Here, regionally, at the state level, and at least for me, there is a clear urgency of the next 33 months to try to accomplish and move as much as we possibly can, and we need your help, and we will be in conversation with you, and I really, really appreciate you and appreciate your time, and that's why I want to also introduce Assemblymember Alvarez, who, together with all of us, we're going to finally make sure that Sacramento is not in your way anymore, that your good work and your service happens finally because of, not merely in spite of, what's happening in Sacramento. So thank you all so, so, so much. Appreciate you.
Well, who else wants to be Ben Chita's next best friend, right? So thank you, Ben. I appreciate your words. He doesn't know this, and nobody else really knows this. I've listened to him before, and I follow him. I've never had the chance to sit in this way. I didn't know if I was at a TED Talk or at an Apple event unveiling a new. Very cool. He's very cool. I'm going to be a little bit less cool, a little bit more structured, but mainly because I took some notes, really in reflection. One thing that I think I do well, is I do listen to people. And I listen to what they say, and I value what they say, because if you're speaking, you're sharing something that's really important to you. And as he spoke, there were a lot of things that came to mind to me. One of the things, I was on a plane coming home yesterday. You know, my routine is I fly up to Sacramento on Monday. I come back home on Thursday. And yesterday, I was on the plane with one of our own in our own backyard, Regent Maria Anguiano, who's a UC regent who was doing some work in Sacramento. And we were coming down together, and she was telling me about a conference that is being held starting on this Sunday. And Ben just said he's here now, he's flying to Santa Clara, but he's going to be back again on Sunday, I believe, to go to this conference. And I only say that because we have to acknowledge and appreciate that Ben is like on the ground, listening to what these conversations are in order to benefit the work that he's doing. And so I do appreciate that. You know, he talked a lot about the master plan for higher education that's 60 plus years ago and how it hasn't really been revisited. I would actually argue that for a few years now, there have been some attempts, perhaps not as well thought out, but there have been some attempts by certainly the legislature and administrations, governor and others, to try and tweak and make changes to address the issues that were mentioned in the presentation about, for example, the disparities and the gaps and the inability to fill the jobs. And some of those are happening right here at Southwestern College. So when Ben asked about the things that keep him up at night, first of all, I was thinking, thanks, because $50 to $70 billion budget deficit is not enough to keep me up at night. Having a 14-year-old teenage daughter and a 10-year-old kid isn't enough to keep you up at night. Now he's giving us three more things to keep us up at night. You know, but the last one that he mentioned was really, I kind of like was struggling and I was kind of challenging that assumption that where is the hero? And as I just sort of was thinking, okay, I've been in this job for a little less than 2 years. I have seen a lot of heroes right here at Southwestern College. And we'll talk about a little bit of the things. I'll mention a few of the things about why I think that has happened. But I think it's also important to always, when I talk to a group of people, even though many of you have already heard my story, to understand my origin story, because the work that is that I'm doing, like the work that you all do, is probably rooted in your personal experience of where you come from and how you got to where you are. So like Dr. Sanchez, I think some of you might already know, I'm from the community of Logan Heights, Barrio Logan, one of the poorest communities historically, like many poor communities in California, changing, some will say gentrifying, but definitely changing, but certainly with a lot of struggles growing up in that community. I'm the son of immigrants who never had even a first grade education, the first, youngest of six, but the first and only to go to college. My parents immigrated to this country undocumented, and really struggled with many of the things that many of our students, families do in the South Bay. And that's why, you know, when a couple of the speakers talk about what's happening in the South Bay is exciting, it really is exciting. Things are lining up, and Southwestern College is at the center of it. I think I said that last year when I was here, but without Southwestern College, this excitement and this transition that we're going through would not be occurring. So you should all be very proud of that. Yes. So you heard the labor market data from experts and researchers. This is not political speech, really. It's the numbers and the data speaks for itself. The state continues to face a workforce shortage in many sectors, such as healthcare and in education, which demonstrates that we have a critical need for higher education programs. Legislature is committed to that. Certainly the administration is. We've seen that time and time again. I have the unique responsibility and also heavy responsibility, I would say, of sitting as the budget subcommittee chair of on education finance in a year that has become more challenging, the most challenging year actually in the history of our state in terms of our deficits. But one of my top priorities or my top priority from the beginning has always been education because of what it's done in my personal story, right? Being poor, being an English language learner, not having anyone who had the opportunity to ever go to college before, trying to navigate those systems and still been able to have done that only would have happened and only did happen because of the educators in my life, both K-12 and in higher education. That's why I continue to believe that our education system is the pathway. And one of the things that I've come to learn, and maybe not learn, but remembered and appreciate even more so now, is how successful our community college system is actually at producing successful people who enter the workforce, whether it's right after college through a degree, associate's degree, a certification program, but even into a four-year career, a college career. The most successful students who go through our universities are community college students. That's how valuable it is, and I don't think people, the general public, really appreciates that. But how do we make sure that more individuals have access to that? You saw, again, the graphs. They were very clear. Latino, black students, and first-generation students have the least access. One of the things we're working on and that will increase this access that I want to make a pitch for at this point, even in a budget deficit, we need to continue to think about how we're going to increase that access. And one of the ways to accomplish that is something that the legislature and the governor came together on and agreed to, which was the Cal Reform Equity, Cal Grant Reform and Equity Framework, which really, thank you for those in financial aid who understand what that is. It is going to ensure that these disparities that exist and these systems that exist that were built many years ago on a different type of student, including students who maybe did not, non-traditional students who maybe didn't go from high school into college right away, they get left out of some of these programs. Students who are older, who we know are often served at our community college and they start their new college career in community college over the age of 28, they often face, because of existing Cal Grant, they also face the lack of the financial support in order to continue their education. So we know, the data is clear, it's been analyzed, that over 140,000 students today would benefit, the vast majority, Latino, black, and community college students would be the ones benefiting if we enact Cal Grant reform. So that's one of the things we're working on this year. Again, this is something that's going to cost us money, roughly $250 million, but the return on that investment, we know what that is. You've heard about it and you all know it. So that's one thing that I really want to make sure that we focus on, and I want to share that with you. The other one is enrollment, right? And so when we talked, when Ben talked about the who, or we talked about the who in the presentation we heard earlier from South County, from the EDC, we're talking about those students who currently don't have the access. And that's where Cal Grant reform comes in. But enrollment is also an issue. We were seeing declining enrollment. And this is, again, where the heroes of making sure that people have access are in this room. Because not every community college system or district in the state is doing what Southwestern College is doing. There is more enrollments today than there was pre-pandemic. And we measure a lot of things now in pre-pandemic, post-pandemic. And in the world of education finance, we are measuring that in terms of where have students gone. We are seeing less students on campuses. We are seeing less students in our K-12 system. But you know where we're not seeing less students now are at places like Southwestern College. So what we need to do is we need to identify what is Southwestern College doing that's different from other college systems where they are not regaining those students and where their enrollment continues to decline. And so this is where, again, Southwestern College stands out because they are able to share the model of how they're doing, how they're being successful. But then the state has to respond. And in a year with a budget deficit, we got to figure out how we're going to spend our resources more and investments in ways that are more strategic. We need to spend them in places where our dollar is reaching and it's being multiplied. At Southwestern College, that's happening. So Southwestern College will be a big player in this conversation of how do we make sure that we fund the future of college and community college and college in general, making sure that we get those students back so we provide those opportunities. Other types of heroes, you heard about President Sanchez with Sweetwater just this week signed dual enrollment, right? That is We should applaud that, but you know, as Ben said, like you know, the 1964 framework or what we call a master plan for higher education did not talk about that or really envision that. So these molds are being broken at the local level, and that's where we are seeing that more students are also having access to through dual enrollment programs. So we need to figure out how to make that simpler. It shouldn't take that long for us to figure out how to do that because it's clearly working. It's providing more access. And we need to do it more frequently. One thing hasn't been mentioned today, and I was surprised, because I know how successful it's been and how proud you should be at Southwestern College, but other colleges are doing this as well, is the programs in our prison system. When you talk about reaching everybody, and unfortunately the reality that in our prison system we are overrepresented by Black and Latino communities, not representative of our sample of the population in our state, when you are intentional in going into those spaces, you are going to help reduce those gaps and those disparities that exist. And Southwestern College has one of those, if you don't know, and you should, one of the most successful programs, because we know that these are members of our community that are gonna come back into our community. And shouldn't we rather have folks coming back in our community ready to continue their lives in the way we expect them to? After all, our prison system's name is Corrections and Rehabilitation. Southwestern College is doing some of the most important work in rehabilitation in our correction system, and you should all be proud of that. More heroes in that space. And I have to talk about also now about a bill that I have that is controversial. But Southwestern College, I think, knows me well enough that we like to take on these issues, and we were successful last year with a bill that I'll talk about in a second, but AB 2586. You're going to hear about this a lot. You're probably going to hear about this a lot if you tune in once in a while to places like Fox News. AB 2586 is to recognize, again, those gaps that exist between our talent that we are, the pipeline that we are creating, and the students that are coming through that pipeline. We have tens of thousands of students, which California decided about 20 years ago, primarily through AB 540, who are undocumented, who are living in our communities, who unfortunately our federal government has refused to find a solution for these dreamers, for these young people who were brought to this country when they were oftentimes infants, usually very, very young, who we in California have said, we value you and we believe you deserve the same education as every other student. And that is a great thing that we decided to do. What isn't talked about, though, is that once those students receive their education and get their degree, unless you're a DACA student, which unfortunately that program has also ended and the federal government hasn't fixed that either, and that's only a small percentage of undocumented students, unless you are one of those students, guess what happens with your degree? You cannot go into the workforce. You are not allowed to be employed because of federal immigration law. But this is where education comes in, and we have other heroes, like at UCLA Law Center, where we had legal scholars do an analysis of the 1986 Immigration Reform and Control Act. I only know that really well because that was the year, 1986, when my parents finally became legalized through that, the last time we did immigration reform in this country. And that law was very specific that employers cannot employ individuals who are undocumented. But the law was also this legal theory by these scholars, which is about a 27-page legal memorandum, which I'm happy to share with all of you, and I've read about three times, identifies that the law was actually silent on whether governments and arms of the government can employ individuals who are undocumented. So these legal scholars at UCLA Law Center provided this opinion, well-researched, and it is based on that opinion that I've introduced AB 2586, which would allow our colleges, like Southwestern College and the other 117, or roughly, I think is the number of colleges throughout the state, the UCs, all the campuses, and the CSUs, to employ undocumented students on their campus, utilizing the talent and the skills and what we've invested in so that they can actually put to work their talent. It's limited, but it's the framework we've been given in a failed federal system that hasn't done their job on fixing immigration laws. So AB 2586 is one that I hope you're interested in and that you communicate with us. I think I'm going a little bit long. I was going to talk a little bit about first-generation students. I'm a proud first-generation student. We've got to continue to invest in those students and continue to invest in the programs. I cannot leave, though, and I'll end with this, without talking about the work that was mentioned earlier on the University Now initiative and the future Chula Vista University campus. I want to tell Ben, the governor texted me. I got elected a little less than 2 years ago, in June. It'll be 2 years. He texted me, governor reached out to me and sent me a congratulatory message. I responded with one thing only to the governor, and that it was that I was looking forward to working with him on growing higher education opportunities, particularly at a Chula Vista University campus. So the work that we have done through things like AB 91, which Southwestern College led, which was breaking the mold again and identifying that we are not just a San Diego workforce, we're a Cali Baja workforce, a San Diego Tijuana workforce. We're now students from who live much more closer to this campus actually than I do, and I don't live that far. I live in Barrio Logan. It's only about a 12-minute drive for me, but students who live closer to this campus than I do, just happen to live on the other side of the border, can be part of the students who we train because we know they are part of our workforce so that our students can attend at affordable rates. That idea has caught on. Governor signed that into law, recognizing that we are a region, so we appreciate that. We also, though, need to continue to work on this University Now initiative, through the University Now initiative, on which are the academic programs that we want to bring to this campus. We're not just looking to replicate. Ben, we're looking to break molds. We're not just going to bring a biology program, another psychology program. We are using the research done through the University Now initiative, the input through the community and the business and all the other stakeholders, to attract the programs. When I was here last year, you might remember, I might have slightly offended UC San Diego, very, very lightly though. And I called them out. I said, San Diego State University is at the table. We need you to be at the table as well. Dr. Sanchez already mentioned to you in his points earlier, they are at the table. We have everybody now at the table for this university initiative and for this future university campus. We have made tremendous gains in the last just couple of years with the help of, for example, Senator Steve Padilla, who was helpful on the Senate side in the legislature. And so while we are making progress now, and this is gonna happen, we also must recognize the work that it took for over 30 years to get where we are. And so folks like Mary Salas and Mayor John McCann, who's Mayor of Chula Vista, previous mayors as well, who have really been focused on this, there has been a lot of work, but we really are where Dr. Sanchez said, at that, those of us who have been following this on a day-to-day basis, we get the chills because we know we are really that much closer to bringing programs and a university to the South Bay here in Chula Vista. So it is with all of that that I continue to be excited about what is happening at Southwestern College, want to be a partner always in what Southwestern College is. You should all be very proud of what you all bring and add to the table here at Southwestern College, because Southwestern College is responding to the needs of today, but always looking beyond today, beyond our borders, literally and figuratively. And I'm excited to be here today to say we have work ahead, but I'm proud to be one of the many who are in taking the lead and making this work happen. So thank you very much for having me. Appreciate you.
Thank you, Assemblymember. We are so proud to have you as our representative in Sacramento, and we stand ready to partner. I have to tell a story as I ask our other speakers to join me on stage. It was about 2 years ago that we decided to do something different for Undocumented Student Awareness Week, and we hosted legislative luncheon for our legislative reps. Please come up and join me. And in that luncheon, Alejandra, which many of you know, had the students kind of surround in a fishbowl setting our legislators and share their lived experience. And the assembly member, he has to leave, but he would tell you that time and time again, the students speaking would share the hard work they were doing, but also the feeling of a little bit of hopelessness, because once they got their degree, what would they do with it? And the challenge of paying their way through college. And so it was that conversation that kind of spearheaded. So I want to recognize the assembly member and his staff who took that feedback, listened, and now we have the bill before the legislature. So we do have a couple questions, only a couple, so this Q&A might be really quick. So Ben, you inspired us, and we want to know how we can help shape the master plan for career education for our community and influence the state's plan. How do we get involved?
Yeah, so I want to point out two separate ways to kind of think about it, or at least the way I think about it. The first is like inputting in. So think about the problem that we're trying to solve for. How do you co-create the vision for a new way to think about all of education in the labor market with 39 million other people? And so the way that we're trying to do that right now is basically there's a couple ways to plug in. One is we've been having these regional convenings that I saw some of you at, I saw Z and Mark at, but there's those. There's still a couple left over, including one virtual, one that you could sign up for. Two is you could submit anything. So we have a team of about 100 people over at WestEd that are analyzing everything for us. So think about like that problem I just told you about. 39 million people ingesting ideas. I need a brain to digest it and then give it back to us, like basically give us a, how do you actually fit all these pieces together? So if you want to send WestEd, this team of 100 people, you can send them anything you want. They'll read it all. You can meet with, and then, but they'll kind of incorporate it in. A third thing that you could do is you could request a meeting with the governor's office team, whether it's WestEd or the team. There'll basically be a team that kind of meets with whatever group makes sense, just to kind of hear feedback and whatnot. And then otherwise, we're kind of just open to any other ways that you want to plug in. Like I said, we don't really have a game plan here. No one remembers how you do a thing like this. Like I said, that 84-year-old intern didn't remember how you do this. So That's all to say, you can find information about all of this on careereducation.gov.ca.gov. Again, that's careereducation.gov.ca.gov. And the main ways are regional convenings, send us paper, get a meeting with us. You know, the next time that we'll put out a new version of what we're going to call preliminary solutions is in July. So just try to plug in that way. The second thing I really want to emphasize, though, is a lot of people. I'll share with you like my lived version of this, which is like, if you Google me, you'll find that I shared my like mental health story recently. And the way I experience it is like, it's so heavy. This load is so heavy. I can't do this if people are looking to me and being like, Ben, how do we influence you? And then how do we get you to do the thing? I don't know how to do the thing. I am around for 33 more months to do my very, very best. And that's why I'm emphasizing the second piece, which is we're gonna need your help. It is inputting, yes, but to be real, there's only so many ideas under the sun in terms of how do we do the ed code. The big problem over the past 64 years has been the political will to actually get the fucking thing done in Sacramento. And so that's all to say, that's really where we need you. It's 2024, we're talking to people, we're putting out ideas about what we're looking at. 2025 and 2026 are the big fights. We're gonna be taking on big fights. Some of you might be on the other side of those big fights, I don't know. But it's at the end of the day, what we're advancing is big change, which necessarily involves big fights. And so that's all to say, the second big thing I want you all to think about, in addition to inputting, is how do you start organizing yourselves? How do we start building the network of people who are going to make sure that the job gets finished? Because I need help, and I can't do this. Like, I literally cannot mentally handle the feeling of being responsible for
Ben,
this.
You are in an organizing community right now, yes. So you're in the right place. We'll make sure that we send out that information for folks who registered, and we'll make sure that we share it on our socials as well. Taylor, I have a question here about employers. Are employers receptive to their role in helping to support education? And what do colleges, specifically Southwestern College and community colleges, need to do to be good partners?
Yeah, so I think that it's hit or miss, right? You've got some employers who are ready to innovate and do things differently and understand their talent pipeline differently, and some that are still making their way there, beginning to understand that a lot of the barriers are being put on ourselves, right? They're just the way we've done things forever, not the way it has to be done. So I think there are several companies, especially here in San Diego, that are really ready to do things differently, look at things differently. We've had great stories of companies that have gone through this process with us and understanding, you know, going through the process of understanding what they're looking for to help them then see what other sources of talent might look like around the county. And so I think that's been really successful. And then generally just thinking about what other forms of talent or what other training sources might exist. Apprenticeships are something that have come up a lot recently, and non-traditional, what we might consider non-traditional apprenticeships, and we see a lot of activity around that in the region too. So short answer is yes, for the most part. I think a lot of the employers that we're working with are receptive to this. And they do understand where the investment is needed, where their time is needed. One thing that I think is important to note is that for many of these companies, their core competency is like building continuous glucose monitors or like building ships for the Navy, or like they're doing these really big important things. And so as seamless and effortless as we can make it for them to engage with community, engage with education, and that's not to say they shouldn't be trying harder, they absolutely should, but the kind of collaboration that we can do on the education side, on the training side, to make sure that those companies can spend most of their time like saving people's lives and also have some time to come and give feedback on what the skills are, I think that's a really important piece of it.
Thank you. Okay, Dr. Sanchez, And I know I saw our superintendent out here earlier. What is the college district doing to work with elementary, high schools to change the mindset of what student career plans look like and encourage parents to change the conversation with their child? For example, talking to students at a young age that being an electrician, a plumber, a mechanic is just as gratifying and well-paid as trying to be a doctor, engineer, or lawyer.
No, that's a fantastic question. And one of the things that I noticed about Southwestern College when I arrived in 2021 was for some reason our outreach component was not as strong as it used to be. And outreach is an important consideration when you're running a community college because engagement with the community should always be strong, whether economic times are good or economic times are bad. You should always have a connection with your community. So one of the first things we did was invest in building a very comprehensive outreach component for the college that would engage with not only our schools, K through 12 in our region, but also our business and industry partners, our community-based organizations, to really influence career and educational opportunities that exist at Southwestern College. That resolve only strengthened when I read the San Diego Regional Economic Development Corporation's Inclusive Economy Report that highlighted 84% of the positions that exist in San Diego County require a degree, certificate, or credential. So when you look at business and industry in San Diego County, you see Pfizer, you see Solar Turbines, you see UCSD Healthcare. You just instantly know that many of those industries have jobs that require advanced credentials. So in investing in our outreach department, which is very, very strong now, a lot of that was first and foremost building pathways with our Sweetwater Union High School District and our outreach team, and I know Dr. Jocelyn Pacheco, I don't see her in the room, last year did a first iteration of a program called Southwestern College Explorers where we had 1,500 incoming high school freshmen come onto campus and get an exploration of our programs that exist here at Southwestern College. As a matter of fact, when students were signing up, the line went down to Otay Lakes Road, and it was quite a sight to see. So as you build that partnership with your high school, then you can begin having conversations on how you backward map to create exploration projects with your middle schoolers, your elementary schoolers. So we actually had San Isidro Middle School here just last week. There were two busloads of students here exploring our programs, both career and university pathway. And so I think as we've invested in that outreach component, they've been able to do some tremendous work. And we also bought an outreach van that is actually equipped with Wi-Fi and other components that we can actually take out into the community and meet the community where they are in terms of the programs and services that exist at Southwestern College. And so as we've invested in that team has turned around and built tremendous programming with our K through 12 partners all the way down to elementary school to get them to explore the programs and engage the families on what programs exist at Southwestern College.
Thank you. We have two questions left. Ben, this one I think is for you. How is the Department of Labor and Department of Education aligning with your efforts or collaborating to ensure the supply of workforce will be qualified for the changing needs?
I love this question because it gets at one of the big problems that we have, which is the massive silos. So I'll answer the question and then I want to kind of think about it a little bit more. But so the main one of the things that we did recently, just as one proof point, is I chair this thing that we call the Governor's Council for Career Education, and it actually includes basically everybody that should be part of the conversation at the state level, at least. So we're trying to build on that, and we want to build regional structures as well. But basically, at the state level, the council includes, for K-12, Tony Thurman and Linda Darling Hammond. For higher ed, Sonia Christian, Millie Garcia, and Michael Drake. And Kristen Soares for the private independent universities. And then it also includes Stuart Knox, the labor secretary, Dee Dee Myers for business development, the Chamber of Commerce, and the Labor Federation in California. So what we're trying to basically do, and the reason why I want to talk about, I think the sort of underlying point of this question is very, very good, which is we've come up with labels that are super outdated. Like education and workforce are outdated labels. It's the same fucking thing. It's like, right, it's labor supply generation and cultivation. And then labor demand, as you were talking to Taylor, it's like demand driven. What you want to basically do, what the state should be trying to do, is to help mediate a good and healthy conversation dynamic between labor supply, which is K-12, higher ed, and workforce systems, and labor demand, which is employers. Not only do we have to mediate that conversation, people have to be incentivized to have that conversation. They need to be rewarded for that conversation. It can't just be an employer basically like doing their extra, you know, like what you're basically talking about is goodwill from employers. It's volunteer work, basically, oftentimes, which is like there happens to be a community, you know, an employer in the community that cares, and they're willing to take their, you know, after work hours and join a meeting and whatever. But they're basically volunteering. My point being that the right way to think about it, the 2024 way to think about it, is there's two sides of the ledger: labor supply, labor demand. On the supply side, everything between K-12, higher ed, and our workforce systems should all cohere and make sense from the individual student's perspective to answer the question, how do I cultivate and build on my labor sort of value, so to speak? That's the supply side. And then we have to talk to the demand side, which is employers, both public and private, and basically say to them a number of things. We can't let them off the hook either. We let them off the hook way too often. We have to say, what do you need? Yes, absolutely. What do you need 10 years from now? Yes, absolutely. But also we have to say, what are you going to give us? How many employees will you commit to hiring if we pay for half the paid internship, for example? What's the ROI here? Let's make a deal. We have to be doing that. That's the role. That's the new way that we should be thinking, in my view, of the government's role in all of this work, which is why I love this question, which is like, education, labor should be at the same table? Fuck yeah.
Quote them. Okay, the last question is actually two, and so I'm gonna take the first one really quickly. How do we get involved and provide input on the University Now initiative? If you are here at Southwestern College, Laura Brooks and Diana Arredondo are two faculty co-chair who are leading the task force and looking at degree programs at Southwestern College and how it aligns with the uni. So speak with them. If you are general community, you can go to chulavistaca.gov, University Now Initiative. You'll find the report. You'll find ways that you can just send in comments. But the question around uni that I'm going to give to Taylor and Mark and Ben, feel free, because it's really all around what you just said. It was a great transition, and that's that talent pipeline management. So how do we ensure that students are getting practical degrees and not ones that have limited or no job opportunities? And I think that's kind of the magic sauce in our University Now initiative. So do either of you want to speak to that?
Yeah, I can start. And this is a sticky question, because there's a version of education that exists to create a whole human that is incredibly important and valuable. There is also a version of, maybe we call it workforce development or education, that is training people and teaching them the skills they need in order to make money, right? So I mentioned in my presentation that we are inspired by a framework called Talent Pipeline Management that's developed by the U.S. Chamber of Commerce Foundation. I say inspired by because this framework is very strict and regimented, and so we have to get a little bit creative about how it looks for different projects in San Diego County and in South County and for the uni committee as well. But the way that it works is that it takes, it treats talent supplies like supply chains that you would look at in any other piece of business. So you say, let's start with the employer, the end customer of this talent, and ask them what they need, just exactly what Ben was just saying. What do you need as far as numbers? What do you need as far as skills? And what do you actually need as far as credentials, right? So we really like to break it down to the skills piece, and I think that makes it easier to communicate about things. And then we bring that information back to our existing colleges and universities, or let it inspire what new programs are going to be brought to a certain area, and say, we're going to develop this curriculum based on this fact. And in some cases, you tie commitment from an employer to the development of that curriculum by saying, if we're going to do this, you need to commit to hiring all of these students. But in some cases, you can kind of look at it from a holistic view and say, generally, we know that this is going to be better for all the students in this region. So we won't ask for commitments from employers, but we'll continue to elevate the work that we're doing here and highlight that this is how we're training students, strictly based on what they're looking for their workforce, going back to the comment that I made about return on investment, so that when a student's done with a community college program or a university program or a skilled trades training program, whatever it might be, that training actually got them what they needed in order to successfully do the job and get paid for it. So that model, like I said, is called talent pipeline management, and we borrow and are inspired by that model.
Yeah, I'll just chime in really quickly, and I think the question is an excellent one because it's one that at the college we have to remain nimble, because essentially we're training for industries out that don't currently exist. With mm-hmm. the way that evolution is happening with artificial intelligence, it really is a matter of our faculty, working with our faculty and giving them the support and the resources they need to stay in tune with the evolving industries. I used the example earlier in my speech around hydrogen, automotive hydrogen technology, and I want to acknowledge Brian Palmateer, our faculty member, for his excellent work. But our students are actually training in the classroom on hydrogen desktop simulators. But that's a result of our faculty staying in tune with the industry needs, how it's evolving. So I think that's really the key, is really keeping a pulse on how things are changing. And it's part of the reason when you look at other colleges' models for what they call educational master plans, oftentimes you'll see those are written out for 10-year windows. We actually wrote ours out just for 6 years because our business and industry occupations are changing so rapidly that 6 years from now we'll have to do this again because we'll be planning for new industry sectors again that don't currently exist. So I think it's really keeping a pulse on how much everything is changing and then being able to adapt with those changes.
To build off of what Assemblymember Alvarez said earlier too, it's looking at what our needs assessment did was it did an educational needs assessment and a workforce needs assessment together, so breaking down the silos, right? And so we're looking at being innovative at programs like the hydrogen program and what are the programs that bring added value to our region. So thank you for that, Dr. Sanchez. I lied. There another question came in. One's a comment. I'm going to read it as a comment, even though it's a question, because I know the University Now Initiative, we get so inspired, and everybody wants to go, or how is this going to be funded? So there's a funding, like, how's this going to be funded? But I'm going to phrase it as a statement, because it's important. So when funding considerations are made, there's a great opportunity to expand workforce development programs to happen during out-of-school time, in before and after school, in intercession programs, and involving CBOs, community-based organizations, to work with education systems and businesses to implement these. That needs funding. I'll leave it at that, Ben.
Is that the question? Or
it was a question. If you want to answer it, I know you're not the one who allocates funding, but it's a statement, really, and a question.
Yeah, no. So, I mean, so two things. So, also, I also wanted to touch on the last piece, too. So, mm-hmm. sorry, a couple thoughts. One is, on the funding side, that's exactly why, also, we need to have a master plan. I know I'm, like, a broken record on this, but I'm so tired of having these conversations about bright spots and pilots and all these things. Yeah. We have 116 colleges, we have 116 bright spots. Let's fucking turn these bright spots into the actual spot here. At a certain point, we have to do the thing. And so my point being that, like, absolutely, we should be trying to figure out how to fund these things continuously as opposed to one-time competitive programs and all these things and one-time pilots, absolutely. But that's a big conversation that Sacramento's not ready to have, and I need your help to actually have that conversation. The second thing is, speaking of high schools, funding isn't actually the problem even. It's the logistics, it's the master schedules, it's the transportation, it's all that jazz. That stuff, we have to think about how high schools fit together with community colleges, how dual enrollment works out, how work-based learning works out. That's a lot of stuff that we actually have to kind of, that's a big set of conversations that we need to run.
Okay, we'll close out with one question. Oh, did you want to add to that?
When we're at the end, okay. If I can.
Yeah, absolutely. We'll close out with one question. Anyone can answer it, but there's a few questions in here around entrepreneurship, small businesses, and how is our education systems ensuring that we meet the needs and the flexibility when all of these big plans are in place and in our outreach and the work that we're doing to kind of engage that component of the workforce.
Yeah, I'll just jump in actually, and if you want a model for how that's done successfully, visit our Small Business Development Center or at our National City Higher Education Center. I see Dean Perry here, and I know I saw Daniel Fitzgerald here earlier also, and Kathy Ibarra. The Small Business Development Center, the Women's Business Center is doing amazing work in supporting small businesses in the region. And helping people of color as well as women become small business owners and entrepreneurs. So if you want to see the model in action, I encourage you to visit our National City Higher Education Center. It's an amazing operation that's doing tremendous work. And as a matter of fact, Daniel Fitzgerald, our small executive director of our Small Business Development Center, has been recognized with several community awards, as well as Kathy Ibarra, who was recognized by the White House for her work in building the Women's Business Center. So that's the answer to that. And while I have Ben Chita up here specifically, I want to acknowledge that when Assembly Bill 91 was sitting on Governor Gavin Newsom's desk last October, Assembly Bill 91 is the assembly bill that allows our binational students to enroll in San Diego Community Colleges for the in-state tuition rate, thereby removing the barrier of cost. $46 a unit compared to $400 a unit is what the difference is in terms of being able to enroll as a resident student in this region. It was Ben Chita's leadership that was actually able to get in front of the governor and get this done. So Ben, I just want to thank you for your work. I appreciate your leadership.
Taylor, did you want to chime in on that? And then we'll have Dr. Sanchez say some closing words.
Absolutely. I just want to share a program that was formerly run through Advancing San Diego that's now run through the K-16 Collaborative, which is funded by the state, which offers paid internships for students that are part of these programs that have been designated for teaching the right curriculum and just reaching and serving the students that reflect San Diego. Those students have the opportunity to get paid internships, making about $22 an hour over the summer at companies, and it's no cost to the companies. So for a long time, we did this very specifically focused on small businesses. It's expanded a little bit now, but that still remains a really important focus of the program. So essentially, small businesses can sign up to host interns. The cost of hosting the interns on them is just their time and effort. The interns do get paid through the program. So I think as much as we can continue to do work like that, San Diego has a higher concentration of small businesses as compared to the national average. And so that's a really important segment of our economy here, and continuing to ensure that they have the talent that's needed in order to go the extra mile and become maybe a medium-sized or bigger business is gonna be critical. And it's mutually beneficial because the student also gets a really unique hands-on experience at a company that is right in their own backyard. So continuing programs like that and funding that program, I think will be really important.
Thank you, Taylor. Thank you, Ben, for being a part of the program today. Just in closing, if you're not excited about the work that's happening at Southwestern College, you should be. We're more than a South County entity. We are a regional and statewide player. We are a powerhouse. It took a global pandemic to come in and impact our community, and we've come back stronger than ever. So I'm so, so proud of the work that everyone is doing here, and it's gonna be a sight to see. But I wanna thank you all for your support of Southwestern College. It's gonna be interesting to see where we're at next year at this time. But thank you all for your support. Thank you for being here today. And if you have any further questions, please always feel free to reach out, because this is your community college. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.